thank you. Thank you very much. And it is a joy to be back again and to share with you. I want to encourage you to open your Bible to two different places tonight. I want you to find Matthew chapter 21. In a moment, I want to begin reading in verse 28. And then the Gospel according to Luke chapter 17. And in both these passages, Jesus speaks a very clear, understandably rebuking word and a very blunt word to our hearts. And while you're making your way there, thank you for the wonderful time of worship, and so glad that you're here. I had the opportunity this morning to go to Pine Valley Baptist Church and speak to the senior adults. I'm told they had the largest number of senior adults in the history of the Wilmington Baptist Association. So we had a great time over there this morning. So they've all repented and got all them saved now. And so now I've got to get over here and deal with you folks. But thank you, Pastor Kenny, for the opportunity to be here for a couple of nights and share. Men, if you've not signed up for our men's conference, we're talking about demolishing strongholds. The Bible makes it clear that we need to guard our hearts and our minds, for out of them are the issues of our life. So what's in here is what issues forth out of our life. And if we don't deal with our thoughts, they become actions and deeds, and then they can become habits, and then they become strongholds. There can be things in your life that you feel you have hold of, and if you don't deal with it properly, it gets hold of you. And so I'm going to walk you through text all of, at our men's conference starting tomorrow night, Lord willing, on how to demolish, and that's the biblical word, to tear down strongholds. And then we'll deal in particular on Saturday morning with pornography and the damage that it's doing to our marriages and to our churches. And I'll say it again, you can be saved and deal in pornography, but you're not filled with the Holy Ghost. And okay, I was just wondering, but if you heard that, but you're not. God is not in control of your life, and you'll never have the rich marriage or the rich walk with Jesus. And the enemy's really, really using that, and you'll see why I'm so passionate when I speak on Saturday morning about that. I want to talk to you tonight on this subject: regrets, bad choices, and second chances. So if you have your Bible in your hand, I'm going to ask you to stand with me to your feet. And I'm going to read Luke's gospel first in verse number 3. And I want you to listen carefully. Jesus said, "Take heed to yourselves. If your brother sins against you, rebuke him. And if he repents, forgive him." You ever heard someone in the church say, "I'm just going to be honest with you. I don't care what they say, I'm not going to forgive them." By the way, if you think you're in control when you talk like that, you don't understand what it means to walk with Christ. You can't have the relationship with Jesus that you ought to if you have bitterness in your heart, unforgiveness. So you got to forgive. I've heard people say this: "Well, I'll tell you one thing, I'm going to forgive them, but I'm not going to have anything else to do with them." I want to just say this to you. If Jesus were to say that to us, we'd be in a world of trouble. "Johnny, I forgive you, but I don't want to have anything to do with you." And the very fact that you're forgiven really means that you are forgiven. And if you're forgiven, you genuinely have released someone. And if they've not been released, you've not forgiven them. In other words, you know in your heart that if you've told someone and in yourself, you've said, "I've forgiven them," but you're at the grocery store, and when you turn your buggy to go down an aisle, you see them, and you change and go another aisle, they're not forgiven, all right? And then just to make it clear, Jesus said in verse 4, "And if he sins against you 7 times in a day," and this is persistent, "and returns to you saying, 'I repent,' you shall forgive them." Now, if you'll look with me in the Matthew's Gospel, chapter 21, and beginning at verse number 28, the Bible says, and this is Jesus asking us to weigh in. Now, I've never thought about that. He's going to make a statement. He says, "Hey, I want you to listen to a story, and I'd like for you to weigh in on it. I'd like to see what you think about it." And so listen to the language. But what do you think? A man had two sons, and he came to the first and he said, "Son, go work today in my vineyard." And he answered and said, "I will not." But afterwards he regretted it and went. You know, it makes you wonder, have we ever done anything exactly like that? And if you're married, the answer is yes. I've said before, I'm not going to do it. And I got this unusual look. And I thought, this is not going to help me. And I regretted it, and I did it. So I will not, but afterwards he regretted and went. Verse 30. Then he came to the second and said likewise. And he answered and said, "I go, sir," but he did not go. So here's one person who knew what was right but chose not to do it, regretted they didn't do it, repented and did it. But here's another one that knew what was right. They both knew what was right but didn't do it, even though he said he would. Never did regret it. And Jesus is about to weigh in on this. So listen to what he says in verse number 31. He says, they said to him, "Which of the two did the will of the Father?" They said to him, "The first," Jesus said to them. "Assuredly, I say to you, the tax collectors and harlots enter the kingdom of God before you." You may say, well, what do you mean by that? Well, listen, he explains himself, verse 32. "For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and harlots did." He's saying, I'm telling you, the major sinners believed the message of John and repented and came into the way of righteousness. "And when you saw it, you did not afterwards regret and believe him." And so what he's saying is, these people that live horrible lives, great sinners, but they get it and they repent. They're forgiven. But the person who seems to be the good religious person understands but never repents will perish. Father, speak into our hearts in the name of Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Regrets could be described as heavy weights. They certainly can impede us from moving forward. Regret is a word which means to mourn the loss or the death of. It means to miss very much. It means to be very sorry for. It's regrets for mistakes. It can refer to sorrow that's been aroused by circumstances beyond one's control or power to repair. It's an expression of distressing emotion as sorrow. There's three things I wrote down that regrets will do in an individual's life. They paralyze us in the past. They interfere with present happiness. And they steal motivation for the future. And so there's really no movement in their Christian life. Not long after I became a Christian, I started memorizing scripture. I love to memorize the Bible. One of my favorite passages is in the book of Hebrews, where the Bible says, "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience, perseverance, the race that is set before us." In that passage, the writer speaks of encumbrances. Let us lay aside the weights. He doesn't say what the weights are. The weights are anything that impedes the Christian's progress. So if there's something in my life that really is holding me back from moving on with Jesus, maybe you can think back in your life and say, there was a time I was growing spiritually. God was active in my life. He was using my witness, my ministry, my giftedness to make a difference for God's kingdom. But then there came a time in your life that now serves as a regret, and it began to impede your progress. And it's oftentimes that people email me or call me and will ask, hey, is this a sin? And it may not be something that the Bible defines as a sin, but it's defined as a weight And a weight is that which impedes your progress. In other words, you can't go forward. You can't finish effectively like you ought to with weights. And then he says, and the sin, and listen to the language, the sin which so easily ensnares us. And the word that's used there is the word of entanglement. It means you've got tangled up in sin. And as a result, that sin's just got a grip on you, and it's impeded your progress, and you've not been able to move forward. And the bottom line is, until you get to the point, listen to this, to recognize clearly what that entanglement is and repent of it. I mean fully repent, you'll never go forward. You're stuck. God might as well take you home. He's not going to do anything else with you because you're not at a point in your life of being usable for His kingdom and His glory. But the Bible says He wants us to go on to endurance, perseverance, bear up under whatever's there by looking to Christ. And that's the very next verse, is looking to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God, which means He finished that what He came to accomplish. I was over at Lifeway speaking to their faculty and all of the people that work in the largest Bible, or in the sense, not Bible, but just Bible curriculum in the whole world. And a lot of people, and they recently did research, and in their research, they received this response to a statement. I am dealing with the consequences of bad decisions. 47% of the people agreed. Now, that was just in the nation, but in the church culture, evangelical world, 44%. Now, let's just say that it played out in this church. It would mean really every other person. It means the person sitting beside you, listen to me, seriously, is dealing with a regret. And if it's a regret that's actually causing the person to be paralyzed in the past, it is impeding upon their present happiness, and it stole their motivation to be able to go forward in the future. That means that in this room tonight, only half of you are at a place that God can even use you, because you're stuck somewhere in the past. Well, I want to see the body of Christ activated. I want to see people become fully embracing of Jesus as a fully devoted follower of Christ. Not just how we act at church, but I mean 24/7, influencing and making disciples in a difference for the kingdom of God. So almost half of this country feels the weight of a bad choice from the past. The Apostle Paul in Philippians wrote these words, "Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus." I've studied that passage any way you can study it, in every way, and have written just sermon after sermon after sermon. So let me just give you a summation statement. The main principle of Philippians 3 verses 13 and 14 is this: Christ-likeness. That's what he's saying. I want Christ-likeness. But he said, I've got to forget those things which are behind. Now, let me define that for you. The word forget does not mean that you have the capacity to not remember it anymore. It means to no longer be influenced by. In other words, it's in your rearview mirror. You may think of it. There can be a breeze one day that just arrests you outside, and immediately your mind goes back 2 years. Janet and I were riding around somewhere today, and it's just a thought came, and good night. I said, I hadn't really thought along those lines in 40 years. And when I made a statement, she said, I don't remember the last time I heard that statement. I said, well, I can't remember anything I thought or said yesterday, but 40 years ago, I can. Occasionally, somebody will come, or you'll hear a preacher or certain church movement will say, I'll guarantee you one thing I love about our church, brother, we believe that when Jesus forgives you and forgets it, not only are you forgiven, you forget it. I got a word to say to that. Liar, liar, pants on fire. Matter of fact, when somebody says they've been forgiven, and not only did they receive the forgiveness, but they can't even remember it anymore. How do you know you're forgiven? I mean, the very thing about grace is that you know that you've been forgiven so much, it overwhelms you with the kindness and compassion of Almighty God. And so it's there, but it's in the rearview mirror. And as you continue to progress, it gets further and further back there, and you see very little of it anymore. So listen to this statement by my friend Ed Stetzer. He said, recognizing a sizable percentage of people are suffering consequences from past mistakes allows Christians to show grace. So really, you've experienced grace, and it really stands to reason, if you've experienced God's grace, one of the ways we'll know is you will express God's grace. So really, with so many people living under regrets, it really gives you an opportunity to really magnify the grace of God in Jesus Christ and be a very gracious person. So Christians minister grace out of grace. So caring for those dealing with pains and regrets is not about fulfilling an obligation or relieving guilt. All of that's already been taken care of in Jesus. So I'm not going to go out there and say, I'll tell you what, I set those people free today. No, I'm telling you, if they've been set free, Jesus set them free. And that's the grace of God, even if he uses you to do it. Now, the vast majority of Americans believe God gives second chances to those who have made bad decisions. In other words, 98% of all the evangelicals agree that God gives second chances. So let me just hear, and you just respond by amen if you agree with his statement. God is the God of a second chance. That's fair, all right, but thank you. Some of you don't like to vote, and that's all right. We're just glad you came. But I want you to listen to these percentages. I want you to track with me, because this is an indication of where we are in the church and where we need to be. So listen to this. 19% of Americans believe God gives second chances when a person depends only on God. And I want to be honest with you. That's where I am. When a person depends only on God, God is the God of a second chance. 18% of Americans believe God gives second chances when a person makes restitution. What they're really saying is, unless they make it right with me, they will never be right with God. Well, I want to be honest with you. I believe that when a person is genuinely repentant, they will get God's forgiveness and they will make restitution. But listen to me carefully. God's forgiveness is not predicated on man's response. And if you believe that, you have a man-centered religion and not a God-centered religion. You might as well remove the cross. It doesn't matter that Jesus died for your forgiveness. Somebody that's never able to die for your forgiveness, you're still waiting for theirs. That was a good word. Write it down. That's a good word. Thank you, preacher. I'm glad I came. 15% of Americans believe that God gives second chances when a person does good enough. 11% of Americans believe God gives second chances when a person promises not to repeat the mistake. But by the way, I am going to ask you to vote. I think I'll involve you in this sermon. How many of you have ever done something, said you'd never do it again, and you did? That's all of us except for a few liars, all right? But to say that you've never said you'd do something and you didn't do it. That was all of us. And some of you are like me, you raised both hands. My buddy Ronnie Floyd, because a lot of folks were weighing in, said this. 44% believe God's offering a second chance depends on some kind of human action. The problem with trusting in oneself to gain a second chance from God is that we cannot trust ourselves to get it right. So why put extra pressure on ourselves to fix things we can't? The most scriptural response to failure is to ask God to intervene and to accomplish his will. More and more I studied this subject and I wrote, here's a statement I wrote down. Regrets are powerful and painful. And by the way, think for a moment. Regret has got to be powerful if it's paralyzed you. Man, if it stole your present happiness, it must be some powerful tool the enemy uses. And indeed, regret, if it's keeping me from having motivation in my life for the rest of my life, stealing my life, man, it must be one powerful tool the enemy is using. So past regrets have choked out our confidence in Christ. And so ignoring past pains causes present pain. So the reason some of you are in pain tonight is because you hadn't dealt with the pain in the past. And so it's not that you think, I just don't know why I can't get forward. It's really like 2 Kings chapter 6. There's a story of a man who is chopping wood. And while he's chopping wood, he loses his axe handle in the water. And so the question is, how does he get his power back? You get the axe head. Where do you get it? Where you lost it. You go back to where you lost it, and you find it there. It's like the person that was looking under a street light, and someone said, sir, can I help you? He said, yes, if you would. I've lost a great sum of money. Said, so it was in this general area? Said, no, it was way down the street, but this is the only area there's any light. You'll find it where you lost it. I'm asking, in the name of Jesus, listen to me. I'm serious. 2 or 3 years ago, you got off on the wrong track with God. You've got to get back. And I wrote a simple statement. This would be as clear as I know how to write to the body of Christ and to those who don't know the Lord. What if you've wronged someone in the past? You've genuinely sought God's forgiveness and theirs. You sense that God has forgiven you, but they will not let it go. They will not let you forget what you did by their treatment, their actions, their attitude, and their body language. And if you don't understand what I just wrote, there are many times you don't have to say a word. It's the way you act. Body language is really loud. So the question is not, well, what's the right thing for them to do to me? No, it's not about you in that sense. The question is, what's the right thing for me to do? And let me tell you what I've learned. I can't control anyone else. Someone says, here's the way a person is treating me. I can't control them. What I can do is respond to God and let him control me and me have the proper response. So you extend to them the same grace that you wish extended to you. I have a man in my church, and I want to set this up. I want you to really catch my heart, and I'm being as honest before God as I know how. I'm going to read a clip from a letter or email I received a couple of weeks ago. And this man, to me, I've been his pastor for 27 years. He's one of the most mature believers in our church. He has one of the largest Sunday school classes. His class constantly rebirths another class. He produces more workers within the ministry. He's a great discipler and a great witness for Jesus. But he has regrets in his life. Most of us that have lived very long at all will have a regret. But listen to this. He said, I'm so thankful for the blood that washed me from head to foot and then washed my stinking feet when needed. And you may say, what is he talking about? Have you studied John chapter 13? Do you remember when Jesus was receiving the disciples and he was washing their feet? And Simon Peter came. Jesus got ready to wash his feet, and Simon Peter said, Lord, you're not washing my feet. He said, well, I'll tell you this. If I don't wash your feet, you have no part with me. He said, whoa, wash me all over. Listen to what Jesus said. You have not need to be washed all over because you've already been bathed. What does that mean? He's already been saved. He's been washed in the blood of Jesus. Well, why does he need his feet washed? Because even though we've been saved and we're on our way to heaven, in this old world, from time to time, our feet get dirty by not responding right. And that's why we need to confess our sins. The Bible says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And there's not a single one of us that live in such a way that our feet never gets dirty in this world. And so some people say, what a great message on service it is. What a great message on humility it is, but that's not the main message. The main message of John 13 is, what forgiveness? What forgiveness? Jesus, because Jesus said, "Is I have washed your feet, is I've forgiven you of your dirty day-to-day stuff. Go and do likewise. Go and do what? Go wash other dirty feet. Go forgive other people that do the same thing day in and day out that you do. And by the way, the Holy Ghost showed me that. Just write it down. I'm telling you, everybody magnifies service. Everybody magnifies humility. And Jesus is talking about forgiveness. I have washed your feet. Even though you've been washed all over, your feet got dirty. And I washed them. And now you go and wash other people's feet. You forgive them as well. So Buddy goes on. Here's what he says. I can't seem to totally get past my past because it seems some just refuse to let me. It breaks my heart that within the body of Christ, there are those who seem to consider his blood totally sufficient for their sins, but not quite sufficient for the sins of others. Isn't it amazing how marvelous and powerful the forgiveness of God is in your life? But isn't it amazing how sometimes we think that someone else is beyond the powerful, perfect forgiveness and blood of the Lord Jesus Christ? Galatians chapter 6 said some light on forgiveness. And I want to translate this for you. And it's really a verse that really means a great deal to me. At Woodstock, for the last 16 years, God placed it in my heart to start what's called a city of refuge. James Dobson said it's the only one that he knows of this nature in the entire world. And what we do is we have 11 pastors right now at Woodstock, 26 children. Cost us $1.2 million to do this ministry at Woodstock last year. Preachers spend their time ministering to the people and their needs. Question, who ministered to the pastors and their needs? If the average pastor in America told his congregation that he was hurting, they would probably say, we need to find somebody that's healthy. And before too long, he'd be given a small severance, emphasis on small, and he would be replaced. I'm not being ugly. I travel all over America. I'm as involved as a preacher knows how to be in trying to help churches and pastors. But listen to this. So here's these pastors that are at our church, and we're ministering to them. And in the context of these guys, Galatians 6:1 is what we share. Matter of fact, the number one song in contemporary Christian music last year was written by Benji Cowart. So all of my great praise singers and worship singers back there, you ought to know the name of Benji Cowart, because if a preacher knows a singer's name, singers ought to know singers' names. All right. But Benji Cowart, and he wrote the song, Redeemed. I'm going to shake off these heavy chains. That song was written. You know when it was written? He wrote that while he was at the City of Refuge. Benji Cowart. I was preaching in Nashville last week. He just moved from upstate New York. They're at Niagara Falls, Buffalo. And he has been serving in a mega church with several thousand people every Sunday that is pastored by Jerry Gillis, that was converted under my ministry in 1989. So he's up there pastoring. And then Benji had been in one of our churches out in Las Vegas, went through a time of getting burnt out, brought him and Jen into our church at First Woodstock. And while he was there in that midst, wrote that song. But let me give you the verse that we use most when we do public restoration of these preachers after they've been in our ministry. Galatians 6:1. Listen to it carefully. Brethren, if any man is overtaken in a trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. The word overtaken in the Greek text is a word that means surprised. How many of you know that sometimes people make terrible choices and they never thought about making that choice? They didn't premeditate and think, I'd like to go out and make a choice that would ruin my life. They were surprised. In other words, the enemy set an attack up. Now, they've got to take full responsibility, but it's not something they went looking for. It's not a premeditated sin in their life. But instead, they were overtaken. They were surprised. They even got honest before God later and said this, if somebody would have told me that I would have done this, I would have come across the desk and done bodily harm. I never thought I'd do anything like this. How many of you know that people have done things in their life that if it were possible, they'd undo it? How many of you have ever spoken a word and you wish to God you could retrieve it? And you would if you could, but you couldn't, and now it's a regret. You say, man, I said something, I wish I'd have never said it. I did something I wish I had never done. So here's the question. Can I treat someone with grace who sinned against me in the same way I wish to be treated if sinned against? And here's the word of God. The inspired word of God says, listen, if somebody's really done wrong, they've been overtaken in a fault. Be you who are spiritual, and you're showing whether you're spiritual or not. Well, what it means is if you don't treat them right, you're not spiritual. You're carnal. You're of the world. You're fleshly. But he said, if you're spiritual, restore. And the word restore means help set this broken bone. This person's hurting. The last thing you need is for you to go in and break another bone. Now, I'm going to make a statement, and I'm going to go ahead and say this. I'm getting ready to make a statement. I don't even like what I'm about to say. But I'm going to say it because you've heard it, and I want to apply it. Have you ever heard somebody say this? I used to go to church, live for Jesus, and man, I'll tell you, I made some bad choices. And man, I'll tell you what, the people I ran with at the church, man, the way they treated me. I just couldn't take it, man. I was struggling enough with my own guilt and them for to just load more guilt on me. So bottom line is I went down to the bar and I pulled up and I began to share my story with the guy beside me, and he bought me a bottle of beer. I don't like telling what I just told. And I pray, God, that it doesn't happen near as much as I'm afraid that it does. People are living with regrets. Now, this is all introduction, so I want you to really hang with me. Pastor, 27 years, the same church. Not me, a friend of mine. And he made some really poor choices. He had a track record. No, stay with me. 27 years, man of God, God using him, God blessing him. And then he really made some poor choices. But he wrote me a letter the other day. He sent me a CD along with it where he'd given his testimony. Here's what he said. In January, Pastor Johnny, it'll be 10 years since I arrived at Woodstock, Georgia, to enter your city of refuge to begin my journey of forgiveness and reconciliation. At that time, my world had crashed and I was as low as a snake's belly. However, during the following 17 months, God breathed new life into my broken world, not only for me, but for my wife as well. My children just flew to the West Coast yesterday, my oldest daughter and son-in-law, and my two oldest grandchildren. They lead the largest music tour in the world. Give you some idea for all you music fans. Justin Bieber had 360,000 last year. That was number two. New Song had 560,000. And they're out there, and a fella traveled with them last year, and I've become buddies with him, and I love his music. His father is a Baptist pastor in Michigan. And so I got to meet his dad, and we connected. So the other day he wrote, and he said, Pastor Johnny, the next Sunday I have off, I'm coming to Woodstock. His name is Matthew West. He wrote a song recently, and it's entitled, Hello, My Name Is. And I want to read the lyrics, and you know it, but listen to this. Hello, my name is Regret. I'm pretty sure that we've met. Every single day of your life, I'm the whisper inside that won't let you forget. Now, I want to be as honest and transparent before God as I can. If you are a genuine worshiper of God, I mean a real worshiper. And by the way, I love the worship here, but I want you to hear me. This is not where my worship begins. My worship begins in intimacy in the Word of God and on my knees with Jesus in the morning. Matter of fact, I'm Baptist-costal in my prayer time with the Lord. I'm just telling you, that's where I have the greatest joy. And then I love the other too. I mean, I'm a big fan of worship and love what we've experienced here the last two nights. But the bottom line is, any person that's being honest has had their hand up to the Lord before and heard a whisper. Put that hand down. People around you knew what I know. You wouldn't raise your hand. Now, if that's never happened to you, you're just too young. He says, hello, my name is Defeat. I know you recognize me. Just when you think you can win, I'll drag you back down again till you've lost all belief. And then he moves into this part. These are voices. These are the lies. And I believe them for the very last time. Hello, my name is the child of the one true King. I've been saved, I've been changed, and I've been set free. Amazing Grace is the song I sing. Hello, my name is the child of the one true King. It goes on. It's a great, great song. Now, I've done all that, and I'll do this quick because you're thinking, well, you got to move on. Well, we're moving. Here we are. I'm going to give you steps to deal with your regrets. Now, you could write it down in one word. And the reason I tell you to write it down, a dull pencil is better than a sharp mind. And if I give you six statements, and I'm going to give you six succinct statements and just simply illustrate them and then wrap it up, I want you to get them. So these are steps to deal with regrets. Number one, determine, or just keep the word in mind, determination. Determine what your regret really is. Some people are full of regrets and they're not even sure what the regret is. So here's what you've got to determine tonight. Pastor, if I'm paralyzed, I can say there was a time in my life God used me. I was growing. God was making a difference in my life. But the truth is, there's very little progress. I don't sense the activity of God in my life that I did at one time. And so the question is, let's just try to determine tonight. What's the determining factor? Is it something you did or something you didn't do? Sometimes people regret what they didn't do. Oh, I wish to God I'd have been there more for my mother before she passed. Well, whatever it is. Oh, I wish I'd have never done this. Something someone else did or didn't do to you. Sometimes we're holding something against someone. Did you know that sometimes we're holding people captive and the people are not even aware of the fact that you're holding them captive? And you might even say, look at them, just like nothing happened, look at them. And they don't have a clue what you're talking about. So sometimes it's a circumstance beyond your control. And sometimes it's not that somebody needs to do something to set you free. You need to get right so you can be set free. And so there needs to be a determination. So that's really a pretty simple statement. But what is it that you regret? And what are you going to do with it? So that's just step one. And we're going to move into it. Number two. The word I would use is two words, forgiveness and restitution. Ask forgiveness from God and make restitution with the offended. In other words, you repent of the harm you did. I mean, the bottom line is, I've said things to people. I've acted in certain ways to people. And sometimes they may not even catch it. And I may go home and God really deal with my heart. And I think, you know, I was a little coarse. I was a little short with them. And so I've made calls on Sunday night and just said, hey, listen, man, when we were together tonight, I was sort of short with you and maybe a little offensive. And I've just asked God to forgive me. I want you to forgive me. And he said, preacher, I don't know what you're talking about. And I'd say, well, listen, whether you know or not, do you forgive me? And they say, yeah. And I said, good. Have a good night's rest. But repent of the harm you did. And listen to this. Forgive yourself. I wrote a sermon about 7 or 8 weeks ago on how to forgive yourself. It's become one of the most requested sermons I've ever preached in my life. God is my witness. A guy called the office the other day. I answered the phone and he was crying just so uncontrollably. I could hardly understand his words for a few moments. And so I just held on. In a few minutes, he said, Pastor Johnny, you don't know me. I appreciate your secretary piping me through to you. And she said, here's what he said. I've just listened to your sermon on how to forgive yourself 17 times. So now I said, wow, 17 times. Forgive yourself. C.S. Lewis said that if God's forgiven you and you're not willing to forgive yourself, you have raised up a tribunal above his, and that's idolatry. If God says, I forgive you, and you can't forgive you, you have raised up a tribunal that is higher than God's. Wow. That means that you actually have become a greater judge than the God of the universe. Wow. Number three, accept the circumstances. You say, what do you mean? And the word there is just acceptance. Avoid blaming others, but rather take responsibility for anything that you could have handled better. Let me tell you what I love about Psalms 51. Everybody knows Psalms 51, don't they? Psalms 51, Psalms 32. Psalm 51 is David's great confession. The first four verses he uses a personal pronoun 9 times. You say, what are you referring to? He says, I have sinned against thee. I've sinned against heaven and you. I've transgressed against you. My iniquity is before me. He doesn't blame anybody. He says, I've sinned against you and you alone. He took full responsibility. You know what's wrong with us? We spend too much time confessing other people's sins instead of ours. And Lord, I'll tell you, I'm grateful to God for my wife. And I ask in Jesus' name, you deal with her about her attitude. And so what you're doing, and by the way, listen to me. No, you do it. You do it. Don't. I know why you're laughing. You realize that that's what you're doing. You confess your spouse's sins. Yeah, Lord, you just deal with her, draw her to yourself. But why don't you, while you're at it, ask him to draw you to him? That would be pretty cool, wouldn't it? Well, anyway. So you accept the circumstances. Now, I've got a confession to make, and maybe it'll give you the liberty to be able to come to the same confession. I've been a Christian 40 years. I've been a pastor 37. And I want to tell you who I've had more trouble with. I believe I've actually had more trouble with this one person than the devil himself. It's the man I look at in the mirror every morning. In my Christian walk, the greatest struggle in my Christian walk is not other believers. Matter of fact, I'll just be honest with you. I don't know of a struggle in my entire life with another believer right now other than me. I don't know of anybody I need to call, anyone I need to try to make restitution with. And so avoid blaming others and rather take the responsibility. And by the way, a person's never going to move forward until they take full responsibility for themselves. I had a man that committed adultery on his wife, came and sat down in my office several years ago. And with his wife in front of him, here's what he said. Pastor, I enjoy fellowshipping with you and your wife, but y'all are so busy, you were not always available when I needed to see y'all. And as a result, I began to go places I shouldn't go. He blamed me for his affair for not being more available. You may say, how did you respond? You don't want to know because I had to make restitution, all right? You just need to know this. When you stand before God, and can I remind you of this? Just look at me for a moment. Every person in here will stand before God. You will. You won't stand before Him as a church. You won't stand before Him as a family. You'll stand before Him as an individual. Let me say this to you. No one will stand there and receive clearance because of what you did in your life that was not right. It's predicated on somebody else's response. You can't control anyone else. I will be there to face God as to what I did with what He entrusted to me. Not what He entrusted to you, and not what you did, and not even what you attempted to do or did do to me. Number four, grieve for your regrets. And the word is repent. You may say, when it said he regretted not, it means he didn't repent. Or he relented not, means he didn't repent. So when you feel regret, now listen to this statement I wrote. I want you to hear this. When you feel regret, you relive guilt, sadness, and anger over and over again. Well, what do you need to do then, Pastor Johnny? Allow yourself to experience those feelings fully with the intention of moving forward so you can stop revisiting them. So what do you mean? I mean, the next time you feel overwhelmed about a regret, find you a closet somewhere. Do what Jesus said. Close the door behind you. Lay prostrate before Almighty God on the floor and allow God to work in your heart. And I mean, deal with it fully. I mean, cry out to God. Use every word you can to confess what you've done and be done with it. I think instead of dealing with it, it just keeps coming up and you never stop long enough to deal with it. So grieve for your regret. You may say, well, you really believe that if I've done something, you really believe God really wants to forgive me and treat me like part of His family? Well, let me ask you something. When we read the story in Luke chapter 15 where Jesus left the 99 and went after the one, what's that all about? Where's the one at? He strayed away. Are y'all listening to me? He strayed away. He's wandered from the fold. He's wandered far away from God. Lord, I'm coming home. And he's out there. And I know it. Somebody says, well, I wouldn't go and get him. And so you can just go stick with the prodigal story. It's prodigal son, and say that's the only story in the Bible. No, there's other stories of lost things in the Bible. But Jesus leaves the 99 in the family and goes out and he looks how long until he finds him. When he finds him, he throws him up on his shoulders and he rejoices that he's found him. And I'm just telling you, that's where God the Father is with us. And by the way, let me just say this. When we don't pursue Him, He still pursues us. He still pursues us. Well, let me move to the other two quickly. Number five is the word recognition. Recognize what you learned or gained. You ever heard this statement before? I use it in men's conferences. Never ruin a regret. What do you mean, don't ruin a regret? Use it. Recognize what you learned and gained. There's always lessons from pain and sadness. How many of us can make a statement like this? I went through something in my life. I wouldn't wish it on my worst enemy, but I wouldn't take anything for what God has taught me through it. There's those times, there's those moments in our life when we go through difficult times. And they're not always good things in our life, but God helps us. And then last of all, think through how to avoid having those type of regrets in the future. I mean, not just, I'm never going to do this again and do it, but I mean, think through it and begin to say, I'll tell you one thing, I learned a lesson from that. I've learned something from that. And you might even, if you're like me, end up writing a lesson, writing a message about it, of how to avoid it. Some of you have heard the name before, Hank Hanegraaff. Hank Hanegraaff, maybe you just know him by this. You listen to him on the radio, and he's called the Bible Answer Man. Let me tell you about Hank Hanegraaff. December, first week in December, I join about 70 other guys in Orlando in a very special place to spend a few days. My wife will tell you that I called her year before last, and I said, strangest thing is happening. And she said, what's that? I said, Hank Hanegraaff has followed me all week. I said, I go and sit down to eat a meal with these 70 preachers, and he rushes to where I am like he's stalking me to sit with me. I said, the other day, Janet, somebody was sitting with me. A preacher was sitting with me. He got up to go back to get something, and Hank took his seat. And the reason I'm sharing this story, I'm a big fan. I mean, he's like a hero to me. Bible Answer Man, I mean, he's written so many great books. A very scholarly man. And I remember one morning I got up and I went to the most secluded place in the resort we were at. And I was doing my quiet time. And I already had dressed out to go for a run. And I thought, as soon as I finish, I'm going to go for a run. He found me. I mean, it's like 5:30 in the morning. He said, man, look at everyone for you. And I'm thinking, good night. Hank, he said, hey, you mind if I interrupt you? And I thought, you already have. But anyway, we're there. And so finally he said, I really need to bare my soul with you. And we'd known each other, but kind of just, you know, we're in the same place. So we really became real buds. God connected our hearts. Here's what he said. He started crying. And he said, hey, tell me about your city of refuge. So I began to tell him. I said, there's pastors. Their children have gone south on them. Sometimes the wife is deeply hurt somewhere in the ministry, and it creates chaos in the marriage. Sometimes the pastor's actually had an emotional relationship with someone in church, or it might even become physical. And so as a result, he needed to leave or he was terminated. Sometimes it's financial impropriety. You name it. There's just all sorts of things. So don't ever determine that if somebody's my city of refuge, what they've done, because it may not be what you thought at all. But he said, so you're telling me you spend the money at your church to help get these guys well. And by the way, let me just tell you, they're sprinkled all across the country now. We've had hundreds, are you listening? Hundreds of preachers to come through. My wife will tell you today that I was doing emails back and forth saying, how long's this person been there? Who's coming next? And we were just asking questions. And Hank said, Pastor Johnny, you know what I've done with my life? He said, if I find out somebody doesn't believe right, I write a book about it. And here's what he said. He said, I never thought about it until I heard about what you were doing. And he said, that's why I've been following you around, trying to get up the courage to talk to you about this. And here's what he said. He said, I've been writing books for 30 years. And he said, Brother Johnny, I'm starting to meet some of the people that I wrote books about what they believed. And he said, guess what? There's some good people out there. He said, I wonder if I'd have been like Aquila and Priscilla that showed Apollos a better way instead of criticizing Apollos' way. He said, I wonder how many of those ministries I would have saved and strengthened instead of exposed and ruined. He said, I don't know what to do. He's a scratch golfer. And here's what he said. I've thought about just throwing my clubs away. What he was saying is, I feel like that I shouldn't have the right to enjoy anything else in my life. Why are you telling us this story? Because I'm telling you one of the most brilliant Bible teachers in this nation, are y'all listening? Had a regret. It is so paralyzed him. He thought, I ought to stop. I ought to lay the pen down. I shouldn't play golf. I ought to just stop life. And I said, you know, Hank, I'm getting ready to host a preacher's meetings, and we're going to talk about the next 10 years of our life. He said, I'll cancel anything on my schedule to be there. Do anything to be there. And so since then, we've knitted. God's done a work of restoration in his heart, and he's made his mind up. He's reaching out to people that he's wrote letters about, wrote books about, and he's just saying, I knew what you believed, but I never knew you. I attacked your position, and it really hurt you as a person. And he's asking forgiveness and getting right with God. If Hank Hanegraaff have regrets, other people have regrets. I want you to bow your heads with me. Every person in the room. I'm talking singers too. Band players on every head in the room bowed. This is a time with God. We talk about real worship. This is real worship, where we get real, pure before Almighty God. Here's what I want to ask you a question. And I'm not playing games with you. I'm really being honest before God. I need to tell you why I don't like preaching the sermon I just preached. It has the potential to help. And I believe some people are going to be helped tonight. But there's another part of it. There's a part that bothers me because it's reminded you of your regret. The last thing I want you to do is remind you of it. But if I can remind you of it and help you to get beyond it, to God be the glory. So here it is. If you would say, Pastor, I have a regret in my life. And I've done everything I need to do. But tonight, I'm just going to do exactly what you've just instructed us from the Word of God that we should do. And I want to get done with this regret. I want to leave it in this room when I leave here tonight. I want today, listen, here it's been said in a song, and it was taken from a sermon, and it simply says this, that today could be the first day of the rest of my life. And I mean a new beginning. I recently preached 26 sermons from the longest chapter in the book in the Bible, Psalms 119. You know what Psalms 119 is about? 26 times he says it. You know what he says? I want a new beginning. If you'd say tonight, I want God to really let me deal completely, thoroughly with my regret. I'm tired of being paralyzed in the past. I'm tired of not having any present happiness. And I want God to restore my motivation for the future. And let me say this to you. He never took it from you. You allowed the regret to arrest it. And when you release the regret, you become released and you're once again back in the flow. Now, I want you to listen to me carefully because I realize people are so consumer-driven. People are so performance-driven. And you're always thinking about what other people think of you instead of really being who God wants you to be. So I just want you to get honest before God and only respond as He'd lead you. If you'd say, Pastor Johnny, God spoke into my heart tonight, and I want to leave my regret in this room. When I leave here tonight, stand to your feet right now. If you're the only one to stand, stand. Come on, right now. Father, work deeply in our hearts tonight. Truth is, sometimes our regrets have so paralyzed us, we can't even respond to the Savior who really wants to release us and set us free. And so what we'll do, we'll continue to believe a lie instead of believing that when God saves, He sees us just as though we've never sinned. I thank You that You justified us, put us in a right relationship with You, that absolutely nothing this side of heaven can change. And I praise You for it. God, I bless You for these dozens that are standing. I do ask in Jesus' name that they would thoroughly be honest. And if they have indeed offended someone, then not only seek Your forgiveness, but be honest and bold enough to never try to protect themselves or to promote themselves, but to simply make restitution by simply saying, I'm sorry, and leaving it there and knowing that they've laid it at the foot of the cross and that You can deal with it thoroughly. So God, work mightily in our hearts. While heads are bowed, would everyone in the room stand to your feet? Join the others that are standing. And Lord, in the name of Jesus, just move mightily in this invitation, this brief time for Jesus' sake. Amen. Look this way for just a moment. Some of you have never been soundly converted. I'll tell you, I've preached this for 25 years. I'll believe it until I go to my grave. If there's no change, there's no Christ. Somebody says, I'm a Christian. The question is, have you been changed? Because I'm telling you, Jesus changes everyone that comes to Him. He really does. I'm telling you. He changes you. It becomes a red letter day in your life. When Jesus Christ steps into your life, it becomes the defining moment. So has He ever changed you? Has there been a time that you repented of your sins and you fully embraced Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior of your life? Sometimes people say, oh, I do that every day. No, I'm not talking about what you do every day. That's talking about dirty feet. Have you ever been bathed, washed in the blood of Jesus? My life, January the 7th, 1973. You not remember the date. My wife would have to tell you it was a teenage girl in Myrtle Grove Presbyterian Church when Mickey Rice, an evangelist in the Presbyterian Church, preached, and a grandmother took her, and she was soundly converted to Jesus. But in my life, I was a grown man, 20 years old, doing my own thing, no purpose, direction in life. And I'm telling you, God intervened in my life. I was soundly converted to Jesus Christ. My life's never been the same. Has that ever happened in your life? If not, there'll be people here across the front in a moment, and I'll invite you to give your life to Jesus. Some of you are visiting, and you say, you know, I need to connect with the family of God. I recently read Tom Rainer's little book. I was with him the other day on called Church Member. People ought to be a member of the body of Christ. You connect. This is where you do ministry. You do service through the body of Christ. Somebody says, I don't need the church. Well, evidently, you don't need to be part of the body, which means you evidently aren't part of the body. And the body of Christ is the family of God. So I believe I belong to a body. The word church is used 112 times in the Old and New Testament. 90 times it's in personal reference to a local fellowship. The local church is where Jesus did his ministry through those local bodies. The church at Ephesus, Thyatira, Pergamos, Colossae. The list goes on and on and on. So I'm sure the doors are open for you to come. But most of all, the majority of you probably belong here. And the question is, has God done something in your life? You want one of these ministers to pray with you? I pray you'd come. So as we sing, I encourage you to respond to the Lord. Come on, right now. If God's speaking in your heart, I encourage you to come. May me a recommitment of your life to Jesus, repentance, and recommit yourself to Him. And this be the beginning of saying, I'm going to be faithful to Jesus by the grace of God for the rest of my life. I encourage you to come. Come on right now as we sing.
It's just for you. And He is jealous for me.
God help you to come.
Loves like
God speaking into your heart.
I am a tree bending beneath the weight of His wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions glimpsed my glory, just how beautiful You are and how great Your affections are for me. And oh, how He loves us so. Oh, how He loves us. How He loves us.
I'll just be honest with you. I am absolutely confident God's speaking to people. Let me tell you what don't need to be a regret. That you place your key in ignition in a few moments and regret that you didn't obey Jesus. Too often people hear a message and say this: God spoke directly to me. Think about that for just a moment. Sometimes people even say, Pastor, I appreciate all the other people coming, but really the message was just for me. If you really believe that, have you ever thought about how personal the Heavenly Father must be to speak that clearly, that pointedly? I've already always taught that if God is speaking to you, how gracious and compassionate He is, because if He didn't care for you, He'd leave you in your sin. But He loves you so much that He'd speak directly to you. But what a regret that if God is that personal, and we would still kind of have sort of a halt in our heart instead of a desire to release and let God have His way. And nobody can set you free but Jesus. And nobody can get free until they surrender to the one who can make them free. We're going to sing through one last verse, and if God is speaking, I encourage you to let Him have His way. Somebody could leave free, and this could be the moment of decision that could change the rest of your life. And you know what you could do? You could join with millions of others that are being set free as Billy Graham is preaching around the world at age 95 tonight on this hope. And so Dr. Graham's showing other people. We've had people saved in the homes at Woodstock this week as we've shown his video, and it'll be shown more nights this week. So people are being set free. But the question is, are you free? Let's come. God's speaking, you come.